Clarissa Harlow Barton, or simply Clara Barton, as she is popularly known, began her lifelong commitment to aiding the ill and wounded as a young girl in North Oxford, Massachusetts. Born on Christmas Day in 1821 to a middle-class family, as a young girl, she devoted her time to tutoring children less fortunate than herself and delivered food during the smallpox epidemic in the 1830s. Clara's childhood experiences would foreshadow her future work as a devoted nurse during the Civil War. At 4:30 a.m. on April 12, 1861, Confederate guns opened fire at Fort Sumter, South Carolina. For 33 hours, the shore batteries flung 4,000 shells in the direction of the fort. Finally, the garrison inside the battered fort raised the white flag. The nation had descended into the bloodiest war in its history. From the onset of the war, Clara was determined to provide support and care for wounded soldiers from both sides of the conflict. On the battlefields, she served in some of the bloodiest conflicts at a time when only quinine and morphine were available, and mortality rates were over 60%. A surgeon who spotted her called her the Angel of the Battlefield. The war ended in 1865. And Barton soon founded the American Red Cross in 1881 and served as its first president until her resignation in 1904. As the organization's leader, she provided humanitarian aid and relief for countless victims of natural disasters. Barton died in 1912 at 91 years old, and her home has become a historic site, celebrating the legacy of an incredible American woman dedicated to the cause of humanitarianism. More than a century after her lifetime, Barton's legacy continues to live on through the work of Living Legacy Award winner, the Honorable Elizabeth Dole, born on July 29, 1936, in Salisbury, North Carolina. Dole has dedicated her life to public service. During 1991, when she became the first woman president of the Red Cross since Clara Barton, she demonstrated her dedication to the organization and volunteered her first year at the Red Cross, accepting no salary. It is precisely this spirit of service for the greater good that has hallmarked Dole's career. A Harvard Law graduate, she was one of only 24 women in a class of 550. She married Bob Dole in 1975 while serving as a member of the Federal Trade Commission. Her 40 years of public service also included serving as Deputy Director of the White House Office of Consumer Affairs, U.S. Secretary of Labor, and the first female U.S. Secretary of Transportation. During her tenure, support for passage of a uniform 21 drinking age and a transportation regulation credited with passage of state safety belt laws and airbags in vehicles have saved 400,000 lives to date. During her 8 years as president of the American Red Cross, Dole led the restructure and total transformation of how the organization tests and distributes half of America's blood supply. She and Princess Diana participated in events to raise awareness and funds for landmine victims. She helped Rwandan refugees in Goma, Congo, and the sites of many other international and domestic tragedies. She completed a massive revitalization of relief services for response to local and national disasters. Under Dole's leadership, 91 cents of every dollar spent went to programs and services at the Red Cross. Elected in 2002, Senator Dole became the first woman to represent North Carolina in the United States Senate. A founder of the Senate Hunger Caucus, she strongly supported the McGovern Goal International Food Program and efforts to eliminate hunger in America. Like Barton before her, Dole's commitment to serving the public has touched the lives of countless people.
I'm proud indeed to be a charter member of the National Women's History Museum and to be included in your class of 2012 alongside such remarkable honorees as the photographs of Annie Leibovitz, the words and voice of Dr. Maya Angelou, the writings of Richard Rhodes have educated and inspired countless individuals, and I'm delighted to join in this evening with each of you. Like Annie, Maya, and Richard, I'm very grateful for this award and, more importantly, for your tireless efforts, Joan, and those of your board and other key leaders to build a museum that will showcase the full scope of the history of America's women. The fact that the award I received bears the name of Clara Barton makes it all the more special. One of the honors of my life was to lead for 8 years the organization Clara founded. And over a century after her passing, the American Red Cross remains one of the most positive forces for good this world has ever known. One of the true joys of my 40 years in public service is that the positions I've been privileged to hold have given me opportunities to help women reach their full potential. Now, to those wonderful men who are here tonight for the Women's History Museum, thank you for your strong support. But you're going to hear a few stories, so get ready to hang on, okay? I'm going to apologize up front. Richard, I think I've already shared with you that there may be a few stories tonight. How can I ever forget my first day of class at Harvard Law School in September 1962? "Elizabeth, what are you doing here?" demanded one of my male classmates in tones that can only be described as moral outrage. "What are you doing in this law school? Don't you realize you're taking the place of a man who would use his legal education?" Those were the first words I heard in that law school. I'll never forget it. And that classmate is now a partner in a very prestigious Washington law firm. And over the years, I've told this story around town. In fact, I love to tell this story. And you'd be amazed at the number of my male classmates in high-powered law firms who call to say, "Elizabeth, tell me I'm not the one. Tell me I didn't say that." Let's just let them sweat it out. I also remember a day early in my career when I was serving as Deputy Director of the Office of Consumer Affairs, and I hurried to the Metropolitan Club here in Washington for a meeting with some out-of-town businessmen. "Stop," I was told at the door. "Women are not allowed here." "My name is Elizabeth Hanford," I explained. "I'm from the White House Office of Consumer Affairs, and there are four businessmen who have flown in from Cleveland, Ohio for a meeting. They're waiting for me on the fourth floor." "Lady," the doorman said, "I don't care if your name is Queen Elizabeth. You're not going in." When I became Secretary of Transportation a decade later, in 1983, I took charge of a department of 102,000 where only 19% of the workforce was female. I asked how many women were in this department when it was established in 1967. You know what the answer was? 18.5%. In 16 years, the number of women had increased 0.5%. It was a male bastion. Well, I asked a great public servant and supporter of women, my Assistant Secretary for Policy, Jenna Dorn, to develop a program to help outstanding mid-level women move into senior management positions and to give women in clerical slots a chance to broaden their horizons. This progress program, I'm happy to say, led to great progress. I'll never forget the day a pilot told me in amazement that he heard three distinct voices on the air traffic control system as he approached a major airport, and all three were women's voices. Yes, I thought, the program is working. And on several occasions, women have called after me in major airports to say, Mrs. Dole, I'm the manager of this airport, and it's because of the DOT women's program. Serving as Secretary of Labor allowed me another opportunity to raise my voice on behalf of women in the workforce. As we investigated a number of corporations, it was crystal clear that a glass ceiling was preventing women from reaching executive-level managerial positions in corporate America. As a follow-up, we were delighted that the Congress created a bipartisan federal glass ceiling commission charged with identifying the main obstacles to the advancement of women and minorities and to propose practices to break down those barriers. When it comes to allowing America's women to reach their full potential, no doubt countless doors have been opened, and we've all witnessed much progress and much history. but no doubt we still have more doors to open, more progress to be made, and more history to be written. And ladies and gentlemen, let me assure you, there would be no American Red Cross without the 1.3 million volunteers who cross town or cross the globe to help people they've never met and will never see again. I'll remember forever a woman named Ruth Easton from Mattoon, Illinois. We had to acquire a special pen to honor and recognize Ruth's 80 years as a volunteer in Red Cross Blood Services because our recognition pen stopped at 70 years. I leave you with the words of founder Clara Barton, who wrote, "I have an almost complete disregard of precedent and a faith in the possibility of something better. It irritates me to be told how things have always been done. I defy the tyranny of precedent. I go for anything new that might improve the past. My wish tonight is that America's women will, as they always have, continue to make history by disregarding the tyranny of precedent and by always keeping faith in the possibility of something better." Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen. God bless each and every one of you. God bless this great land of the free, America. Thank you.